Mike mentioned this earlier. There's some amazing technological kind of creations that have come out of Italy and Italians in general, from the radio, microprocessors, nuclear power. Unfortunately, a lot of it happens outside of Italy. Little known fact, one of the first Intel processors was actually designed by an Italian. I wish I could remember his name. His initials are FF, and they were etched into the top right-hand corner of the chip, which is pretty interesting. It's been mentioned a little bit today, so I have to rephrase my original question that I had. Before today, who had heard of quantum computing? Keep your hands up. Who understands what quantum computing is? And then the ultimate test question, who could explain to their grandparents what quantum computing is? Good news, we brought an expert. So Daniele is from E4, he's the chief scientific officer, and I'll let Daniele introduce himself.
Thank you. It's a pleasure to be here in this beautiful place in front of you. I am Daniele Gregori from E4. E4 is an Italian company based in Reggio Emilia, and our core competence is high-performance computing solution, artificial intelligence solution in terms of hardware and middleware, and recently we move also the first step in the quantum computing. And we are here to speak about the quantum computing and the story of quantum computing.
Exactly. So SoftEye and my company, we build private cloud infrastructure, and we've had a long partnership with E4. We've done some hardware development together, and we've sort of prosecuted some projects together. So jumping into it, there's really two quantum revolutions.
Yes. There is two quantum revolutions. The first quantum revolution at the beginning of the last century, with the theoretical foundation of quantum mechanics first and quantum field theory later, that give us the theoretical basis to develop some devices like diodes, transistor, valves, and laser. All of these devices that dominate our life. If you think about your smartphone, your computer, the communication, are all child of this first quantum revolution. In this first quantum revolution, technicians are able to manage atoms in a collective way, a set of atoms together. Currently, we are living the second quantum revolution that started at the end of the century, the last century, and up to now, the paradigm changed to the technicians are able to manage a single atom, a single electron, and a single photon. This changes completely the way we can manage these entities, these physical entities, and the consequences are that we are able today to have quantum computing, quantum communication, and quantum sensor. At the base of this computer, we have the quantum bit, that is the unit of the information. With the quantum bit, we have some feature like entanglement, like overposition and interference that are not available with classical bit. And today we have many technologies that are able to provide us this kind of qubit.
And there was really sort of two main algorithms that have led to the unlocking of quantum technology. So we have 1994, we have Shor's algorithm, and then 1996, Grover's algorithm.
Yes, at the beginning, we have theoretical studies that indicate that is an advantage to use quantum algorithm that improve some particular problems. The class of problems named non-polynomial hard problem. This class is improved with quantum computer. In particular, Groove algorithm from Peter Shor, the Shor algorithm was the first, and is applied in the field of information, in particular cryptography. All communication in the internet is based on RSA key. Currently, with the most powerful supercomputing, we need some billion of years to crack this kind of key. But with adequate supercomputing in terms of qubits, we are able to solve this key in a few seconds. This is a big problem for the security of the Internet. And this is the reason of huge investment of government in this field. For instance, I come from the IEEE Quantum Week in Seattle. The German government invests in the Quantum Valley in Bavaria around 46 million in the next 3 years. But the US government invests in a Fermilab in Chicago around 600 million in the next 5 years. And if all the milestones will be achieved at the end of the 5 years, another round of investment will be ready from the Department of Energy. It's a very game changer for the Shor algorithm, in this case of security, but it's a game changer also for optimization of function, for logistical problem. You can think also for artificial intelligence, where you have to optimize the so-called function cost. With this kind of technology, you can improve your results. Another important point is the simulation of physical system, like molecular. To simulate also small molecular, you need a number of bits that is larger than the number of protons of the universe. With a few hundreds of qubits, you are able to reproduce around like all the molecular. This is a real game changer from this point of view.
So we were talking a little bit backstage around sort of Italy's role in quantum, right? Because I didn't know this until I sort of started doing a little bit of research, but it's a US firm that's got a fab in the US, but they're doing a lot of their research here in Italy, in Napoli, is that right?
Yes, we have an Italian company that is able to provide a superconducting system. It's a kind of technology adopted to build this qubit. And it's a technology that works at a temperature of millikelvin and needs a big device named cryostat to realize this temperature. And need also a lot of electronics to control this quantum processor unit. There are also other small startups around Italy and Europe too. Yes, also with that manage different technologies.
Mm-hmm. So it kind of seems like we've got this really interesting paradigm. At one end, we're trying to reduce the amount of power that we use in data centers, and there's some really interesting stuff that's happening there. And then we're talking about superconducting quantum computers that need to be kept at crazy low temperatures that are going to be really high power. How are these two things going to come together? Because if the first quantum revolution gave us these things, which are amazing, and then you've got this conflict, is the rest of computing just going to disappear because we have quantum computers now?
This is the question. If the quantum computing will die, the classical computing, well, the answer is no. Because have a different field of application, a different field of problem to solve. We can see the quantum computer as an accelerator for some specific workloads. And the integration between quantum computing and classical HPC will be mandatory. Also, if Ford start a study about integration with other European partners, because it's one of the focus activity in this year. And another point is how to send the data and the workload in two different devices, the classical and the quantum device. But another important point is not related to the execution of a job, but is related to the so-called error correction. Because this kind of machine are prototypes. And are not a perfect machine, are a machine with a few qubits, but with a high failure rate. We need a connection between quantum and classical also to arrange and turn on a system to correct and improve the quality of results of the quantum computer. Another important point is that it's a totally different way to approach the programming of this quantum computer. With quantum gates, with qubits, we need to understand how to prepare the initial state of the problem. This is a big stuff, and also a total white paper ready to write in terms of chapter to understand how to write some algorithm. What will be the better technology? Today we have superconducting technology that works at millikelvin temperature. We have ion trap technology, photonic technology, and neutral atom technology that works at environmental temperature, but use some laser that works at some Kelvin. And we go back at the initial problem. We have to manage a low temperature system. Another promising technology is the so-called diamond technology. It's like a classical server that works at room temperature, but we have to understand how to increase the number of qubit of the quantum processor unit. It is an engineer problem, not a physical problem. We have to understand how to improve this process of production of this device, but is potentially we can solve this problem in a few years, 5, 6, or 7 years. We can have a fault-tolerant quantum computer with 1,000 or 10,000 and more quantum qubit.
So it kind of feels like we're where space was 10, maybe 15 years ago. Incredibly expensive. Very hard to access. What's going to be the breakthrough that gets us to the SpaceX reality that we have today, where it's $1,000 to put a payload into space?
Today we have prototypes with a high price of the order of some millions, and we have to wait years, 5 or 10 years, to have the breakthrough in the production. But what is clear, and this is the reason of a huge amount of investment, that for some problem is a completely game changer. So it is the right moment to start the investment, because we have to define the good, the right technology. We don't have a standard. We have many technologies, but no, we have to define the winner at the end of this stage. And the point is that is mathematically demonstrated that we have an advantage in terms of time to solution and also energy to solution.
But it is available today, and yes. So much so that you can do it inside AWS, if I'm not mistaken.
It's possible to have access via cloud. This is one way, but if someone is interested in a more expensive investment, it's also possible to have this one of these prototypes on premises. Yes, both ways are available.
Okay, excellent. Well, does anybody have any questions around quantum computing? I'm looking at you, Frank. We've got one up the back.
So you just said you could rent out space on a quantum computer. Is that today you could do that?
It's possible to have some prototypes, very expensive, and you have to wait some months, because we have to start, the technology provider have to start the production for this tailor-made system. But it's possible to have.
And do you know what the cost is relatively? Because I think for me, simulation would be like a good use case, but I'm
yes.
sure there's for hundreds of industries and use cases. So
yes, in the case of the simulation, molecular simulation, also logistical problems, some devices are available. You can start to test via AVS cloud, but if you want in premises, are available for around 10 or 20 million. It depends by the technology, the number of qubit, but it's possible.
Any more questions? Frank's got a question.
We are. Quick question about, let's assume, so 10 years from now, whatever, like, you know, quantum computer are emerging, one of the direct effects that's predicted is that pretty much all the, we talked about it before, like SHA algorithms and things like that will just collapse. What do you think is going to happen? Like, if there's any way where should we just clean everything out of the internet? Should we just start to implement right now things that are quantum resistant? Like, what's, because there's the good aspect, but that I guess could mess like banking,
yes,
crypto,
yes.
Like everything. So just curious to know what would you recommend? Like, to should we be worried about that, or what's
a
good approach?
This is the reason that now a lot of universities start to study the so-called post-quantum cryptography to find the more strong algorithm to decode data that are resistant to a quantum computer, and is understood in this year, and is a field of investigation. For me, another interesting point from now and 10 years with the quantum computing is the science of material, with the simulation of molecular. It appears a very promising field, the simulation of molecular dynamics.
Sorry, last question. There's a lot of power that comes with, if you have access to it, like IBM, you know, they have a lot of power. So is there any government regulation over this right now?
I know that there is not a government regulation, but European and US regulation. For instance, it's difficult to have a system built in US because we have, in Italy in particular, some law that restrict import of device, in general, not only for quantum computer, because it's more related to environment pollution laws, and this is the reason. Other technology provider from US and Canada, in my experience, take a lot of money from government, but they cannot sell outside US.
I think there's a bit of an arms race going on as well. I mean, you sort of have the US-China issue. And, you know, to Frank's point of, like, whoever gets it first owns the internet at some level. So how that plays out, I think is going to be really interesting as well. But, yeah, it's a very interesting dilemma, I think. All right. Well, thank you very much, everyone. I think it's coffee time.
Thank you.